Good morning. Praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Welcome to Victorious Faith. I'm Cherri Campbell. We are studying the subject, the power of the blood of Jesus. And we have been studying this now for a couple weeks. And as we are studying the power of the blood of Jesus, this is in a series that we've been talking about the weapons of our warfare. And we started this study by looking in Genesis 3:21. The Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. And then we looked at that. We saw that that scripture sets a precedent for the entire Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament, for the shedding of blood, for the covering. And in the type and shadow, it is the redemption of Jesus Christ. And then after that study, we saw that there we were studying the effects of the blood of Jesus. And we looked at this last week, the effects of the blood of Jesus. Number one, it purchased our salvation. And we studied the word salvation in the Hebrew and the Greek to see the depth and the extent of our salvation. And what does our salvation include? And so we see that the effects of the blood, number one, it purchased our salvation. Number two, we are justified by his blood. Justified means made righteous. So we are made righteous by his blood. Number three, we are redeemed by the blood. And redeemed means to buy back again. And it is similar to the scriptures we studied that we are ransomed by his blood. We are ransomed, we are redeemed by his precious blood. And number four, we are purified by his blood. And number five, we are freed from sin. Freed from sin, so that sin no longer should rule you, but you are set free from sin, set free from bondage and slavery to sin. And number six, we are brought near to God, or we draw near to God by the blood of Jesus. And number seven, we have peace with God by his blood, or by the blood of Jesus. And so these are the things that we have already studied and we have already looked at. Now, let us go deeper into the provision of the blood in our daily lives. And of course, what I've already said, we will continue to build on and emphasize that. Let me say again, the blood of Jesus was not only for the day and the moment that you got born again, that you received Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you were forgiven of your sins, cleansed by his blood, and set free. It was not only for that moment. Yes, that was your initial moment of being set free and cleansed and saved. But that same blood and the same power that's in the blood is for you every day and every moment of every day. It is not something that we should forget about, that we should put aside, that we should put on the shelf, so to speak. It is not something that we should lay down and take no thought of or not to actively receive, because it is for our daily lives. We need the power of the blood of Jesus every single day. And so we need the blood for the things that we talked about. Number one, it purchased our salvation, and salvation bringing freedom and deliverance and liberty, bringing restoration, victory, bringing prosperity and health, bringing preservation, protection and safety, and deliverance from danger, bringing wholeness in every area of your life. That these are things that you don't need only once and then you're set for the life, for life. You don't receive this one time and then you're set for life. These are things that you actively participate in and receive every day of your life. And the same then also with receiving a cleansing of your conscience and then receiving purification, which we're going to talk about more, receiving deliverance from the power of sin, where sin should not be holding you captive. You have to understand that any bondage to sin in your life can be broken by the blood of Jesus, that legally you are already set free. As I have shared with you, you are like a bird or an animal in a cage, and that cage door is wide open, or in a prison, and the prison doors are wide open. Don't stay inside any longer. Sin should not hold you captive any longer. Now, yes, sin becomes a habit of the flesh, and therefore it is a habit that can be broken. Just as in the natural, a habit can be broken. You can break bad habits and create good habits. And they say that even in a period of 6 weeks, by diligent, continuous repetition, you can break a bad habit and form a good habit. And that we need to, as I said last week, we need to train as an athlete. We'll train for a sport or an activity, and it is by diligent practice and repetition that we are to train ourselves in righteousness. So yes, the flesh can be and must be trained in righteousness, and the habits of sin be those habits be broken and a new habit be formed. However, in the spirit, the stronghold of sin is broken by being born again, by receiving Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You are no longer a slave to sin. And we talked about that last week. We looked at these scriptures in Revelation 1:5. It says, "To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood." Hallelujah. And then also in Romans 6:18, it says, "You have been set free from sin." You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. Now that is training yourself in righteousness, but it is the power of righteousness that is supposed to be ruling in your spirit, because sin is broken. The power of sin is broken. You are no longer a slave to sin. And then Romans chapter 6, verse 2 says, well, verse 1, "What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer?" And then verse 6, "For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin." We are no longer slaves to sin. Hallelujah. And so we are, and then Romans 12:2, "Do not be conformed any longer to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." So the power of sin is broken, but then there needs to be a transformation that comes by the renewing of your mind, by training in righteousness, which is discipline, diligent practice in studying and meditating on the Word of God. And as I have shared with you before, that you have to change your thinking, because as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. If you think you are still in bondage, then you are. You have to get a revelation in your spirit of your deliverance. And when you wake up to that revelation in your spirit, the light comes in your spirit and you know, I'm free, I'm delivered, then that will then break that habit and bondage in the flesh. I want you to understand there is a difference between spirit, soul, and flesh or body. And that even though there is sin in the body, it can be broken because of the deliverance that first comes in your spirit and soul. And of course, your spirit is born again, and therefore it is when you are born again that the power of the blood of Jesus sets you free from the power of sin. So you are spiritually set free, but then second comes the soul, your mind, will and emotions, but specifically your mind being renewed and the mind then getting revelation of what has occurred already in your spirit. Your spirit is set free. So then your mind is renewed by studying and meditating the word and the scriptures and get a revelation in your heart and mind. I'm free. I'm free. Hallelujah. I'm free. When that revelation comes, then that will change the habits of the flesh. The body. The body will be the last thing that will change. It first comes as a light and revelation. Well, it first comes by being saved, getting born again, and receiving the spiritual salvation and deliverance, and being cleansed by the blood of Jesus, and the blood freeing you from your sin, breaking the chains, breaking the bondage, setting you free, transferring you out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. There is a spiritual rebirth and there is a spiritual deliverance from the captivity to sin. You are no longer a slave to sin spiritually. Then secondly comes the renewing of your mind, and the revelation has to come to your mind and your heart, your understanding. You have to get revelation. So that comes by studying the scriptures, and the scriptures will build in you the revelation. And when the light comes of revelation in your heart and mind, then lastly, the flesh or the body will respond and be changed. It will be changed. So how do you get free from sin? Number one, you get born again. And then there is a spiritual deliverance from sin. You are born into the kingdom of God, delivered from the kingdom of darkness, and the power of sin is broken. You are no longer captive and slave to sin spiritually. Then number two, you study the word of God and the scriptures that we've been talking about. And you study the scriptures and get the revelation in your heart and mind that you are free from sin. And when that revelation grows in your heart and mind, and you see your new identity in Christ, as we talked about last year, we did a series on who we are in Christ, and you get the revelation of your deliverance, the revelation of your freedom, the revelation comes to your heart and mind, the light comes on in your heart and mind. And then third, that will produce changes in your body where then you can break those old habits. They are simply habits and they can be broken and they can be changed and new habits can be formed as you begin diligently practicing training in righteousness. Training yourself in righteousness, and you will see the change and transformation in your body and your habits, the way you talk, the way you act. When you change the way you think on the inside, coming from the Word of God, the Word of God being built into your spirit and into your heart and into your mind. That will bring the changes that you want to see in your habits. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. That is how you walk free from sin. And there are people everywhere, Christians everywhere, that still struggle with sin. And of course, nobody has been made perfect yet, as long as we live in the body. But we do overcome and get more and more victory by training in righteousness. We develop right habits. Right habits. Righteousness is simply rightness. Righteousness is rightness. And we talked about this already a year ago when we studied righteousness. It is rightness, but you develop right habits by studying the Word of God. It changes your thinking, and then it changes the way you talk and act. Hallelujah. And so you can develop right habits just the way you can in the natural. You can, an athlete will develop habits as he or she trains in their sport. If they're a runner, if they're a football player, whatever it is they are training in, you know, a runner will train themselves to run in a certain way, a certain time, a certain speed, and they are training. And then they develop these habits. Also, then they are developing the way they eat the food. You know, you go into a rigorous training, even of your eating and drinking and sleeping. And you train yourselves in those things as you are training as an athlete. Well, in the same way, we need to consider ourselves athletes in the kingdom of God. And we need to consider training ourselves to develop right or righteous habits. Godliness is something that is trained in. It is not something that comes automatically. Godliness must be trained into you, and it is a discipline that you do it rigorously, daily, practicing it until it becomes habit, until it becomes your natural way of acting. But at first, you are forcing yourself to get up, read your Bible, pray, hold your tongue, don't say those things, think right, don't get angry, be at peace. And you are diligently practicing those things, but those things will become easier because then they become a developed habit and a developed lifestyle. So as a Christian, we should be like an athlete in the kingdom of God, training ourselves and disciplining ourselves in godliness and righteous ways and habits. And that is simply by practice. But you must understand that first of all, you are free from sin. And no matter what the sin is, I mean, or whatever the habit is, or whatever the addiction is, and I'm not going to even say any, because I'm not here to put anyone under condemnation, and you already know. The world knows what is sin. And if you have any question, just go read Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5 gives you a list of the habits of the sinful nature and what are the fruit of the Spirit. And it's a very clear picture. So we don't need to tell you. You know what the Bible calls sin, and it is sin. And again, let me just, since we're talking about sin, and God keeps bringing me back to this because everybody struggles with sin. And yet also at the same time, the world is promoting sinful lifestyles as being acceptable and trying to force Christians to accept a sinful lifestyle and say it's okay. Well, again, we love the sinner, but we will never condone sin and we will never say sin is okay. And why is it? Because sin makes you a slave. and back again to Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. Then it says in verse 15, you know, people talk about grace, and therefore some people think that grace means you have permission to sin. That's an absolute lie. Read Romans chapter 6 and read verse 15. What then, shall we sin because we are not under law but under grace? By no means. Verse 16. Now this is why we don't sin, why we want to overcome sin. Verse 16. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey? Whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death. Sin leads to death. Or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. Or again, go down to verse 22, Romans 6:22. But now you have been set free from sin, have become slaves to God. The benefit you reap leads to holiness. The result is eternal life. Verse 23, Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So you see, sin leads to death. If you sin, then you become a slave to sin, and it leads to death. And we're not only talking about hell. We are talking about the law of sin and death, which we have explained on this broadcast before. It is the same thing as the curse of sin and death. And then you look, go back to Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin. And in this way, death came to all men because all sinned. So sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin. Go back to Romans 6:16 and the end of the verse. If you are slaves to sin, which leads to death. So when you sin habitually, you are connected to and connecting on a continuous basis to the law of sin and death, or the curse of sin and death, which puts you back in bondage, back in slavery to Satan. When you live in sin, you are put back in slavery to Satan. And it was the purpose for Jesus dying on the cross to redeem you, buy you back again, and be the ransom for to deliver you from slavery, out of being a prisoner and a slave. Jesus' life and blood were the ransom to set you free. So why would you want to enter back into that slavery again? You can be free. And so, back to the idea of the sin problem, we should all want to be free from sin. And people who say, well, I want to sin as much as I feel like. Well, they don't understand that as much as they feel like sinning, and they sin all the time, it is putting them in slavery to Satan, sin, and the curse of sin and death, which opens the door to destruction in your life, in any area, physical, sickness and disease, mental breakdown, emotional, marriage, finances, work, in all areas of your life. But obedience leads to righteousness, and the result is eternal life. Well, that word in the Greek is actually zoe life. And it doesn't just mean that you go to heaven when you die. It means a quality of life that you can have on earth, being free from sin. It is the life of God that takes effect in your spirit, soul, and body while you're still here on earth. You can walk in that Zoe, God life, working in your spirit, soul, and body while you're on earth, and you're then no longer a slave to Satan, sin, or the curse, and you're walking in the fullness of life. Hallelujah. That is what comes. That is the benefit. The benefit is Zoe life. I prefer saying Zoe because eternal life, people think of heaven. We're not talking about heaven. We're talking about heaven on earth. We're talking about life here and now in the God quality of life while you're living and walking on the earth. And so the blood of Jesus is a tool for you to be cleansed from sin and to be set free from sin so that it no longer has power and rule over your life. If you find that you are in bondage to any sin, if it's an addiction, if it is anger, if it's hatred, bitterness, if it is sexual sins of any kind, then you can be set free by receiving the blood of Jesus and cleansing of the blood, and by declaring and confessing by faith, I am set free from sin. Sin shall no longer rule over me. Quote these scriptures in Romans chapter 6, verse 2, verse 6, verse 16 and 18, verse 22, 23. Quote these scriptures and declare you are free. Receive your freedom today by faith. And I command over you, the power of sin is broken in your life. If you want to receive it in Jesus' name, amen. Now join me again tomorrow. Remember, God loves you. You are blessed and highly favored by the Lord.